My name is Matt Ferguson, and I'm a graduate student here at the University of Montana in CEHS. So when I first got here at the University of Montana, the requirements for me as a graduate student was to rotate around different labs to see what these labs are doing. The last rotation I did was Tony Ward's lab, and I learned that he does a lot of exposure assessments and community-wide impacts, and that the type of research that I was really excited about, because I grew up in the Central Valley in California, where particulate matter air pollution is a huge source of hazard, I would say. And pretty much every morning I would wake up and hope to see the mountains off on the horizon. Could never see them, and they're right there. That was always something, and the fact that it would impact my health, and it did impact my health. So I knew that it was something important to me and my family. Most of the research I'm doing is in vitro research, so I've been culturing cells, and particularly macrophages. I take these cells and I expose them to these different particles, and I can look at the influence that these are having on these cells. So are they causing reactive oxygen species? Are they causing really high levels of inflammation? Are they pro-inflammatory, is what we would say. Most of my time here was collecting particles. And over this last year, I've finally been able to take these particles and look and see what happens when I expose them to these cells. So I use a particle concentrator. It's a high volume collector of particulate matter. So it's collecting about, 110 liters per minute of air. So it's collecting all this air in. So if it's a regular spring day, and there's probably not much particulate matter, but that's okay because I'm collecting at 110 liters per minute. And so I can still collect a nice number or a nice mass of particles that I can use in these studies. The particle concentrator, pretty much you have outside, everything's coming in through some tubing, and your end point, the particles end up in these three different biosamplers. So I have three parallel lines, all combined about 110 liters per minute. And these biosamplers, all the particles are going into, pretty much being deposited into ultra-pure water. So then I can take these the water and I can lyophilize it or freeze dry it. So all the water is evaporated, and then I have particles. And those particles I can bring up to a specific concentration, make whatever stock concentration I want to make. And we have the tools I need to put those in solution or to suspend them. They're particles, so you would suspend them in a whatever type of media you're using, and then you can use those in your in vitro studies. So some of my preliminary data shows that wildfire smoke has a significantly more of a pro-inflammatory response than wood stove wood smoke. And so what that means is, if you have asthma and you're concerned about exacerbating your condition, here we have childhood asthma is a constant issue here, because wood smoke particles are here year round, pretty much. They're here in the wintertime. Winter inversions cause excess levels of particulate matter. In the summertime, some years we get weeks, if not months, of elevated wildfire particles. And so if you're concerned about an exacerbation or a flare-up of your disease, wildfire particles might be something to be particularly aware of. I'm a member of the Air and Waste Management Association here, and I've been in the leadership of the student chapter here. We participated in the Clark Fork River cleanup pretty much every year, the second or third week in April after most of the snow has melted. The community goes down to the river. It's like a 10, 15, maybe 20 miles. I don't know, but it's a big stretch of the river that the community gets together. There are assigned sections of the river, and pretty much just walk up and down the banks of the river and pick up any pieces of trash. So I am coming near the end of my time here, and I'm getting really excited about the opportunities that are opening up before me. I still have a little bit of time to decide whether or not I most likely will go to a postdoc position somewhere, which will even open up even more doors. And I could end up anywhere in industry or the government or even academia, which I've enjoyed so far. So.
So I'm Tracy Brown. I'm a graduate student at the University of Montana, and I work in the Center for Environmental Health Sciences. So I'm involved with the Air and Waste Management Association at the University of Montana, both at the university level and at the state level. And what we try to do with this organization is introduce students to the field and have them meet people who are currently working in the field, because a lot of the students in the toxicology department eventually want to go into that area. And so some of the things that we do to do that is go on facility tours, things like visiting mining sites or restoration areas. A lot of the students here do research in that area, and so it's a really good way to network with people who we might want to work with and also just learn about what they do and what the day-to-day would be like in that job. And I've had a lot of opportunities to work with the Society of Toxicology, and so that's the group of all the toxicologists within the United States. And the major thing that they do is once a year we meet in different areas around the country to have an annual conference. And they have a graduate student leadership committee, which is formed all by graduate students in tox programs around the country. And at the University of Montana, we're highly encouraged to participate in that. So my first year there, I helped, I was the student representative for a specialty section called the Occupational and Public Health Specialty Section. And so that allowed me to meet other toxicologists with very specific interests in that field, which was something that I was interested in going into as a career. So it was really helpful to meet people outside of the university that worked in that area. And then since then, the Society of Toxicology has a really nice structure allowing you to take on more responsibility the longer you've been there. So the next year I was part of the leadership committee, basically overseeing the graduate students that were the heads of different specialty sections there. It was really nice working with the society because they've been around for a long time and they're highly organized. And so I got to see what a big group like that, how they run, and the inner workings of them. It was also really cool to personally be involved with that and help the organization run. And they always provided me with a lot of support, so I never felt lost. It was just a lot of fun to work with them. And again, I think it was a really good learning opportunity. A lot of research done with obesity and toxicology looks at how toxins can potentially contribute to obesity, but very little is done to see how toxic exposures in an obese individual, if there's any variation to that toxicity or any increased toxicity associated with the addition of obesity. And so we know obesity causes a lot of health problems, increases your risk for cancer and heart attack and stroke. But less is known about how, when you're exposed to a toxic chemical, how that would potentially increase your reaction to it or alter the reaction to it. The first time I came out to Montana, I was doing a summer undergraduate research project. Got to know Missoula, got to know the University of Montana, and really just fell in love with it. So I decided that I wanted to come back for graduate school. When I started here, you first start out doing rotations, tried a few different projects in a few different labs and see what really works for you. This is a time that you're also taking a lot of your classes and learning, getting a strong background in toxicology, kind of catching everybody up to the same level. And then after that point, you choose a PI to work for. I'm working for Andre Holian in a respiratory toxicology lab. And so I've been doing my project for a few years now. I'm starting to get towards the end, getting ready to graduate. And they really try to encourage you to take on more responsibility and become more independent as you're working on your PhD. So when you first start, you've got a lot of help, a lot of support. You're working a little bit more closely with your PI, and he's helping you come up with research ideas and going over experiments, and then by the end you should be able to start coming up with your own experiments, doing your own research, and hopefully being ready to be your own individual investigator. So right now I'm getting close to finishing my PhD, and after you complete your PhD, most students go on to get a postdoc for 1 to 3 years, and that's where you're doing research more independently. You still are working underneath another PI, so another PhD professor generally. They'll help you a little bit, but you're supposed to be a lot more on your own compared to what you're doing as a graduate student. So CHS does a lot to help students become more independent and find ways to get those postdocs. One of the ways that they do that is we have a seminar series that students go to once a week, and they go over what their research is, and then afterwards the students have the opportunity to eat lunch with the seminar speaker for an hour and talk to them about the research that they do. It's a really good learning opportunity to figure out where in science you want to go. We get a pretty diverse array of scientists that come in for the seminars. And it's also a good networking opportunity. Again, while you're getting your PhD, you want to be thinking about getting a postdoc afterwards. And so a lot of these seminar speakers are ideal candidates for people that we want to work with in the future. One thing that's really nice that the center does for the students is we're also allowed to invite speakers ourselves, which is really cool.